It hit the community like a ton of bricks. A series of raids amplified by a frenzy of news stories. Young girls forced to work as sex slaves in abusive environments, unable to leave on their own volition, and spending every waking hour in fear for their lives at the hands of their vicious and unforgiving captors. Reporters rushed to get interviews from police and neighbors and community members. They dug through public records and scoured court filings to piece together what had happened in the confines of the now ominous White House that sat squarely in the middle of one of North Columbia's most traversed business districts. In spite of their best efforts, they had been beaten to the punch by a journalist who had been quietly building a groundbreaking story about the house for almost 2 years prior to the raids.
My name is Brittany Crocker. I started looking into the story about the brothels in Columbia in fall of 2015.
Crocker worked as a reporter at the Columbia Missourian while pursuing her master's in journalism at the University of Missouri. She currently works as a reporter for the Knoxville News Sentinel in Knoxville, Tennessee.
At first, it was a throwaway pitch for a class I was in, investigative reporting, and I had a couple ideas. I really didn't think this would be the one, but I had driven by Shogun Sauna on the way to go pick up a package at the post office. So I wrote down that like there was this place that's basically a 24-hour massage parlor, and that by Googling it, I found out there were others like it in Columbia. And there was just like so much innocence with this class I was in, because there's what here? But people pass that thing all the time. So it's kind of like, well, yes, it exists.
After receiving the go-ahead from her editor, Brittany Crocker used the county's geographic information system to gather intelligence on Chris Felton, the owner of one of the properties playing host to a known brothel.
I think the first one I used was 1125 Vandiver. And I plugged it in and I found the name of the person that owns it. And then I reverse searched that person and found 13 other properties. And through some research, we found out that three of those were brothels. So when I pitched it, it had gotten turned down a few times, and I edited it, and it got turned down a few times. And then I kind of just stopped pitching and started just digging and digging and digging and figuring out how much I could find out about this.
Crocker embarked on her investigation by using open records requests to obtain police reports, as well as interviewing Columbia Police Patrol officers, former Boone County SWAT team deputies, and sex workers who had been employed by the brothels she was probing.
While working on another story, I interviewed some police detectives. I interviewed some patrol cops about the place. I've Sunshine requested police reports about the place. And from there, I found the names of some women that had been arrested there. And so I set up some interviews at the correctional facility. And then from there, kind of started building a story.
Her research eventually led her to a man that she would come to learn had an infamous history in the city of Columbia and the surrounding areas.
It's been so long that I don't remember exactly how I found Barry Manthe's name. It might have just been through White Pages looking at the address. But from there, I started going through CaseNet. I saw that he had been arrested before for driving a woman to a hotel on Portway. There was a sting there. And so he'd been arrested in connection with promoting prostitution, but he ended up pleading to a trespassing charge, pleading down. It was about a $200 fine. I continued to read through the reports, and there were just cases of officers acknowledging that this place existed, which I already knew from some interviews with the police officers.
One report in particular stood out to the journalist. A report that described the casual nature in which the officers responded to the dire circumstances women faced in the brothel.
She had had a warrant, and an officer came in looking for her, and she was in bed, and she said something along the lines of, "Don't go through those blankets, there's needles in there." And then the language still sticks with me in the police report, and it said that this woman had said that she had been stabbed with needles more than however many times over the course of the night, and that she had sex with different men. So all the human trafficking bells at this point were ringing in my head. And at that point, it became an obsession to get this story out.
Brittany Crocker had sacrificed her time, energy, and peace of mind to craft a story it seemed no one wanted her to tell. Her nearly two-year endeavor was about to pay off in a major way.
Two men are in custody today after an FBI raid of an alleged brothel in Columbia.
Barry Manthe and Ronald Clark now face federal charges for their role in the ring.
I was in Knoxville at the time when the arrest happened there, and I got a call from Catherine Reed, the public health and safety editor there. There was an FBI sting or raid at that place that I had been writing about, and she asked me what I knew. She said there was a student who was writing about it. And so I got with the student and we combined what she had, and that was really beneficial because she was able to see what was happening on the ground in Columbia as these events unfolded after the raid.
The research Brittany Crocker had conducted uncovered a wealth of information about Barry Manthe's longtime prostitution enterprises, as well as the illicit sex work industry in mid-Missouri as a whole. But her most startling revelation had to do with how the notorious proprietor of pimpery evaded the ironclad fist of the criminal justice system during his iconic career.
A lot of my research started pointing to the possibility that Barry Manthe, and probably by extension Ron Clark, was serving as a confidential informant to the Columbia Police Department.